Centaur Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Doom and Broom by Annabel Chase. Narrated by Emily Lawrence. Chapter 1.
Today begins a new chapter for our newest student,
Professor Holmes said.
I know we will all enjoy watching her pass this milestone.
Only if they enjoyed vomit. We stood in the middle of a field on the outskirts of town. Five remedial witches and the kindly Professor Holmes from the Arabella St. Simon's Academy, or the Ass Academy, as I called it. The sky was a clear blue, so there was little chance of getting lost in a cloud. I stared at the broomstick in Begonia's hand, a sense of dread creeping through me. I wouldn't be eligible for my own broom until I passed the first phase of the class. Not that I was in a hurry to have one. The only thing I intended to do with a broom was sweep. Hesitantly, I raised my hand. Professor, I don't have to ride alone today, right?
Not to worry, Miss Hart, he said. You will have ample warning when the day arrives for your solo.
Begonia gripped my arm with far too much enthusiasm. And then you get to go to broomsticks for your very own broom. My stomach turned over at the thought.
Now, which one of you would like to take Miss Hart on her very first flight?
The professor's gaze swept across the other witches. Technically, it wouldn't be my first flight, just my first flight on a broomstick. The honor of taking me on my first flight went to Daniel, the fallen angel who was the reason I was stuck in this town in the first place. When he flew me inside the town border, neither of us had any clue I wouldn't be able to get out again, thanks to the curse that kept all supernatural residents trapped in Spellbound. It was a bad time to discover I was actually a witch. Millie's hand shot up first.
I volunteer.
Professor Holmes smiled at her.
That's the kind of helpful attitude I like to see, Millie.
Millie whispered to me.
If I'm up there with you, I won't be in the danger zone.
Helpful indeed.
But I would rather you ride solo,
the professor continued.
Begonia will partner with Miss Hart today.
Although Millie tried to mask her disappointment, she wasn't very good at it. Professor Holmes addressed the group.
Now, young witches, most of you will remember the basic tenets of broom flying from last term: grip, balance, and focus.
Four heads bobbed in agreement. I listened intently, trying to absorb every word.
Millie, I'd like you to go first and demonstrate,
Professor Holmes said.
As I recall, you were our star pupil in this class. That's why I prefer for you to fly solo.
Millie stepped forward with her broom, smiling broadly. I didn't blame her for the self-satisfied grin. I'd be beaming like a maniac, too, if someone told me I was a star pupil of any witch training classes. So far, I was more like the village idiot. Millie mounted her broom, two hands gripping the top end of the handle, and her bottom shoved back toward the bristles. Do you need a running start or something? I asked. How else did they get the brooms in the air? The others giggled.
No, silly, Begonia said. You use a spell.
Does everyone use the same spell? I asked.
There are standard spells one can use,
Professor Holmes said.
But, as with any spell, a witch is free to personalize it, embrace it as her own.
I liked the emphasis on individuality in the coven. There didn't seem to be the idea that every witch was the same. It was nice.
Carry on, Millie,
Professor Holmes said. Millie straightened her shoulders, as much as one could straighten shoulders when hunched over a broomstick. She muttered a phrase under her breath. Professor Holmes clapped his hands twice.
Louder, so we can all hear you. This is a learning exercise, remember?
Millie cleared her throat. If I want to touch the sky, then I need to get up high. The broom began to rise. Millie's expression was serene. She clearly didn't suffer from the fear and anxiety that were my emotional staples.
How does the spell work without her wand? I asked. Millie's broom stuttered to a halt. She turned to glare at me.
You need to stop interrupting, Begonia whispered. It breaks her concentration.
Oops. Sorry, I said softly. Professor Holmes sighed.
Emma's question is a good one. We should answer it first. In the case of broom flying, the broomstick itself acts as your wand. Each stick is imbued with magic. The witch simply activates this magic by focusing her will and using an incantation.
That made sense. Millie glanced over her shoulder at us.
Can I go now? She huffed.
Professor Holmes gave a crisp nod. Millie repeated the spell, focusing her will. I watched as the broom rose higher and higher. When she was high enough to clear the trees, she lurched forward. The longer she was up there, the faster she wrote. I could see why she was the star pupil. Millie was a natural. The crucial element seemed to be that she enjoyed it. With her hair streaming behind her and the sun shining on her face, she was in her element. I felt a pang of envy. Why couldn't I embrace flying with the same fervor?
Well done, Millie,
Professor Holmes called. I doubted Millie could hear him. She continued to zip around in the air until, finally, Professor Holmes sent her owl to intercept her. Now I understood why the owls attended broom practice. My spotted owl, Sedgwick, was with me. He was different from the other owls, which we discovered when I met him at Paws and Claws, the animal rescue center. Sedgwick was my familiar. It was a witch thing, apparently. The other witches in Spellbound had cats as companions and spiritual advisors, whereas I had a cantankerous owl. Lucky me. Millie came gliding down to the ground like a pro, and we all clapped heartily. I hoped my ride was as smooth as hers. Laurel, the youngest witch in our class, was next to ride, followed by Sophie. I'd assumed Sophie would be the problem pupil during broomstick training. She was clumsy on a good day. To my surprise, she took to the sky with ease. Maybe it was just her wand that gave her trouble. Since she didn't need a wand to ride a broom, she performed much better. My stomach clenched when I realized it was our turn. Should I sit in front of Begonia or behind her? I asked. I recalled amusement park rides where the bigger person had to sit in a certain position relative to the smaller one. Maybe it was like that.
You should probably start by sitting in front of your partner, Professor Holmes said. That way she can keep you from slipping off.
Slipping off? Those are not the words I wanted to hear before riding a broom hundreds of feet in the air. Begonia gently touched my shoulder. Don't worry, Emma. Witches rarely slip off their broomstick. The use of the word rarely implied that they sometimes did. It didn't make me feel much better. Don't be nervous, Begonia said. I'll be right there with you. At least I trusted Begonia. Trust was important when someone was escorting you high in the air. Trust didn't stop me from vomiting, however. Begonia straddled the back of the broom and gestured for me to sit in front of her. I swallowed hard. In case it becomes an issue, I said, I would like a wake instead of a funeral. Lots of drinking and good food. And don't have it at Underkoffler's. Piotr Underkoffler was a creepy vampire as well as the owner of a funeral home in town. I didn't want to be left alone with him for a second, even as a corpse.
Understood.
Professor Holmes said. I detected a hint of a smile on his lips. I threw one leg over the top of the broom and tried to settle on the narrow handle. I didn't see how this could possibly be comfortable. As a child, I'd struggled with any bicycle seat that wasn't in the shape of a banana.
Remember, Professor Holmes said, grip, balance, focus.
I paid close attention to the position of my hands on the broomstick. My knuckles were already white, and we hadn't left the ground. I didn't know how to control balance, especially when I wasn't the only one on the broom. Begonia was going to act as our rudder. Her role was to steer and keep us afloat. My role was not to die. Do you want to try the spell? Begonia asked. Maybe you should do it this time, I said. I'll do the next one. Begonia's voice was confident and clear. Take us off the grassy ground to where birdsong is the only sound. I wondered if spells like this ever got misinterpreted. What if the magic assumed that she wanted to be sitting in a treetop near an eagle's nest? I preferred my spells to be more specific. Then again, maybe that was the lawyer in me talking. My spells would be something along the lines of, where the birdsong is the only sound, including but not limited to the empty sky at least 50 feet from the ground or within a 20-foot radius of cirrus clouds. The broom rose quickly and steadily. I felt my stomach dip, and I was glad I'd opted to forego breakfast beforehand. I squeezed my eyes shut. Your eyes are open, right? Begonia asked. That's a requirement. Wide open, I lied. There was no way I was opening my eyes right now. My stomach was relaying all of the information my body needed to know. My eyes would be no help whatsoever. It can be tricky with two people, Begonia said. We all start out riding tandem, but we switch to solo as soon as we qualify. So what was she trying to tell me? She was not as good on a broom now that I was here. I was hoping for a more confident statement. The broom wobbled slightly, and I gripped the handle harder, my nails digging into my skin. I was pretty sure I'd drawn blood. Not that I cared. I was more concerned with not falling off the broom and plummeting to the earth. Look, she exclaimed. The harpies are out. The harpies are out? What did that mean? Now I had to look, or she would know that my eyes were closed. Slowly, I opened one eye just enough so that I could see. In the distance, I noticed three sets of wings. I couldn't determine whether they were ugly bird women or something else. Is it the Miner sisters? I asked. The Miners lived in the house next door. They were a fearsome bunch, especially the grandmother, Octavia. Her tongue doubled as a skewer. Yes, can't you tell? No. I'd only seen the harpies in their human forms. Do they take their harpy forms often? I've seen them appear a few times, Begonia said. I think they like the fresh air. It was like the werewolves in Turning. The harpies embraced their natural state. Both groups tended to live in human form in Spellbound, but there was this whole other side to them. Seeing the harpies airborne now, I understood them a little bit better. On the ground, they were intimidating. In the air, however, I was in awe of them. Where's Sedgwick? Begonia asked. He should be up here. Mine is at 9 o'clock. I made the mistake of turning to look. The quick movement, coupled with a glimpse of the ground below, sent shockwaves through my system. I did the one thing I really, really hoped to avoid.
Bullseye, Sedgwick said, making his appearance. You couldn't have done that better if you tried.
I kept my eyes closed this time. I didn't need to look to know what I'd done. Professor, I croaked.
And a few chunks on Millie, too,
Sedgwick whistled.
She does not look happy about it.
After an abrupt end to class, Begonia and I went directly to Mix and Match to find an anti-anxiety potion. Why not the apothecary? I asked.
Too many members of the coven lurking there, Begonia whispered. We don't want to draw attention to your issue.
Don't witches run both places? I queried.
Mix and Match is co-owned by a fairy, she explained. We don't tend to hang out there as much.
The shop window was decorated with colorful bottles that looked like they were filled with either genies or perfume. I can see the fairy influence, I said as we entered the shop.
Oh, good, Begonia said. Paisley's working today. She's one of us.
Hey, Begonia, Paisley said. I haven't seen you in a couple of weeks.
I've been super busy with school and my new friend. This is Emma Hart.
Paisley's eyes lit up at the sight of me.
The new witch.
She seemed mildly awestruck, and I felt a little like Harry Potter during his first trip to Diagon Alley. I suppose if you're trapped in the same town for the rest of your extended or immortal life, a new resident is a big deal. That's me, I said. Another young woman stepped out from behind the counter. She didn't sport any wings, so I ruled out fairy. Must be another witch.
And how is remedial witchcraft, Begonia? She asked. I took an instant dislike to her, probably because of her snotty tone and the way she emphasized remedial. Classes have gotten a lot livelier since Emma arrived, Begonia said. Thankfully, she opted not to mention today's mishap. I don't doubt it. The other witch came closer to inspect me. She looked about my age, with an aquiline nose, thin eyebrows, and a long, slender neck that was more reminiscent of a giraffe than a graceful swan. They haven't figured out which coven you really belong to yet, have they? Jemima, don't be awful, Paisley said. You know perfectly well her coven is here with us now. Jemima sniffed. I hear your familiar is an owl. She pronounced the word owl with such derision. I have expected a parliament of owls to swoop in and peck out her eyes. I glanced toward the door and sighed. No such luck. Yes, I said. Sedgwick is my familiar, and he's wonderful. Actually, he was a moody thorn in my side, but I'd never admit it to the judgmental witch in front of me. We're here for a potion, Jemima, Begonia said. Why don't you let Paisley help us and go back to regrowing your eyebrows? Jemima's mouth formed a thin line. That was one time, Begonia Spence, and you know it. My eyebrows are fine now. Her finger flew to touch the arched shape of her thin eyebrow. Reassurance. If you say so, Begonia said airily, and Jemima stomped off to the back of the shop. Is she always like that? I asked, once the witch was out of earshot. Paisley bit back a laugh. Pretty much. What can I help you find? Emma is learning how to fly on a broomstick, Begonia explained. She needs something to calm her stomach. And my nerves, I added. Paisley studied me. You're afraid of heights? Very. Well, that's a first for a witch. She began examining the bottles on the shelf. I didn't mean that to sound judgmental. I'm just surprised. That's okay, I said. I knew I presented the coven with a lot of questions, like which coven I was descended from and what my abilities were. We were still figuring it all out. So far, we knew my mother had been a witch, but little else. She drowned when I was 3. I had no clue whether she knew she was a witch. I could speak telepathically with my owl, but not a cat, like the witches of this coven, and I was deathly afraid of heights. So you need something to settle your stomach, and also to prevent you from having a panic attack on the broom? Paisley pulled 3 bottles from the shelf and placed them on the counter. It can be trial and error with potions, I'm afraid. You'll need to test each one for a couple of days and see how your body reacts. I looked at the colorful liquids floating in the bottles. Which one do you recommend I try first? Paisley touched the top of the bottle with orange liquid. This one tastes the worst, but is usually the most effective. Not much different from the human world, then.
And it will help with both issues?
Well, it's an anti-anxiety potion, so it should help with the fear of heights, which should then reduce the likelihood of nausea and vomiting. Any potential side effects? Begonia asked. Paisley gave me a sheepish look. Nausea and vomiting. Begonia patted my back. The key word is potential. I'll try it. I didn't have much of a choice. Take it for a week, Paisley advised. If you're not seeing the results you want, then try the next potion. I stared at the orange goo. This is not going to be fun. Do you want to take the other 2 now, just to have them accessible at home? Paisley asked. I think I'll wait, I said. It feels more optimistic to leave them here. Agreed, Begonia said. How much do I owe you? I asked. Begonia stopped me from reaching into my handbag. The coven is paying Emma. They see it as a worthwhile expense. In that case, you mean Professor Holmes is paying, I said. She pretended to find something interesting on the nearest shelf. The coven is my official answer. I took my orange medicine in a nondescript brown bag, and we headed out for lunch. Chapter 2. Following a leisurely lunch with Begonia at Toadstool's, I decided to stop by Petals, the flower shop. Gareth, My ghost vampire roommate and former owner of my house had requested that I restock his favorite flowers.
"You're that new witch, aren't you?" the owner said. I knew from Begonia that her name was Sybil.
"I'm a Hart," I said. "It's nice to meet you. My friends tell me you're a dryad."
"I'm an ash tree nymph," she said. "We're called the Malia. Technically, dryads are only oak tree nymphs."
"Oops. Sorry," I said. She waved me off.
"A common mistake. I hear you've taken over Gareth's role as the public defender now."
"I needed a job here. I was a lawyer in the human world, so it wasn't too much of a stretch. Except for the fact that I'd never practiced criminal law and knew nothing about the laws of Spellbound."
"Terrible news about Jolene, isn't it?" Sybil said. "I hope you won't be needing to defend someone for her murder."
I froze. "A murder? Who's Jolene?"
"Werewolf," Sybil said. "So you haven't heard, then?"
She seemed heartened to discover she was the harbinger of terrible news.
"Poor dear is dead. She was found this morning in her house."
I continued to select an assortment of roses, careful not to prick my fingers on the thorns.
"That's awful. What happened?"
"Don't know," she replied. "I heard the sheriff is talking to friends and loved ones now." "Was she elderly?" I asked.
"Oh, no," Sybil said with a dismissive wave. "A pretty young thing, about to get married to Alex."
"Who's Alex?" She laughed.
"You really don't know anybody, do you? Alex is a rising star of the pack."
She lowered her voice.
"Some see him as the natural successor to Lorenzo."
I wondered if Lorenzo knew this. I didn't think I'd be happy to discover members of my pack were prematurely planning my replacement.
"You live in Gareth's old house, don't you?" she queried.
"I do."
"Thought so."
She inclined her head toward the flowers in my hand. "He used to choose the same ones."
"Really?"
I feigned surprise. "What a coincidence."
"Is it?"
She peered at me, and I wondered if she knew the truth, that I could see and hear Gareth's ghost.
"What kind of witch are you, anyway? I heard you're not from the same coven as the witches in Spellbound."
"Well, she was very forward." "I don't know anything about my coven. I didn't know I was a witch until the council told me."
"I heard it was that wayward angel that lured you here," she said, carefully arranging tulips in a vase.
"Daniel didn't lure me here," I replied. "The whole thing was an accident. I thought he needed my help, and I did something stupid. Got out of my car and ran toward a lake, waving my arms like a lunatic. He saved me from certain death. I would have either drowned after jumping into the lake because I couldn't swim, or my car would have run me over."
"He used to come in here to buy flowers for Elsa Knightsbridge."
"The mayor's daughter?"
And that red-headed witch, too."
"Meg?" I'd met Meg on my first day in town. She hadn't seemed happy to know Daniel was within shouting distance. She smiled.
"So maybe you know a few people after all."
"I haven't met the mayor's daughter," I said. "Only the mayor." She whistled.
"Truth be told, that Elsa is a piece of work. I don't know why everyone was so surprised when he dumped her. I was surprised he started up with her in the first place."
"People can't always help who they fall in love with," I said.
"It's with whom they fall in love," she corrected me.
"Don't they teach you grammar in the human world anymore?" "Standards are sliding," I admitted. "As long as we're understood, though, what's the harm?" She shook her head, disappointment etched in her smooth features.
"Anything besides the roses?"
"Yes, a bouquet of those yellow flowers. They look cheerful."
"They clash with the roses," she said.
"That's okay," I said. "They're not for me. I'm going to bring them to Alex and his family." She raised a skeptical eyebrow.
"You're a strange one, all right. You said you don't know him."
"Do I need to know him to express sorrow for his loss? Don't they teach empathy in Spellbound anymore?" She considered me for a moment.
Alex lives in the pines. Head due west out of town and you'll run straight into it.
How much do I owe you?
No charge today. Gareth was a loyal customer. I expect you'll be as well.
Thank you.
You're welcome. She gave me a curt nod. Nice to know the standard for manners hasn't gone downhill, too.
Lorenzo Mancini stood in front of Jolene and Alex's house in his finely tailored suit. I recognized the alpha of the werewolf pack from the council meeting in the Great Hall, where it was determined that I'd move into Gareth's house and take over his job. Lorenzo was deep in conversation with a centaur, Sheriff Hugo, the town's leader of law enforcement. The sheriff and I got a chance to know each other during the investigation into Gareth's murder when I was accused of overstepping my boundaries. Needless to say, he wasn't my biggest fan. Lorenzo sniffed the air and turned toward me as I approached.
Miss Hart, I thought I picked up an unfamiliar scent.
Sheriff Hugo grunted in my general direction.
What brings you out to this neck of the woods, Miss Hart?
I held up the bouquet of yellow flowers. I wanted to express my condolences to Alex.
What a thoughtful gesture, Lorenzo said. He's inside with his family.
Werewolves were everywhere. I was surprised the sheriff hadn't cordoned off the house as a crime scene. The front door was open, so I went inside. I identified Alex immediately. He was being consoled by an older woman, possibly his mother. The woman turned and glared at me.
You're not a member of the pack, she said.
Her eyes glistened with unshed tears.
What are you doing here?
I hesitated. Now that I was here, I felt stupid. I was in town when I heard the news about Jolene. I wanted to offer my condolences. Alex lifted his head and looked at me. He noticed the bouquet in my hand.
Are those for me?
I nodded and stuck out my hand. I'm sorry, I said. I don't know what the protocol is here for showing sympathy. This is what people do where I'm from.
Werewolves don't give flowers, the woman snarled.
Alex accepted the bouquet and handed it to the woman.
Would you be so kind as to put these in water? One death in my house today is quite enough.
She bowed her head, a submissive gesture, and disappeared into the kitchen.
Alex Ricci,
he said.
You must be the new witch.
Emma Hart, I said. I didn't mean to intrude.
No.
He wiped the tears from his red-rimmed eyes.
It's a nice gesture. I appreciate it.
He tilted his head in the direction of the kitchen.
Please excuse my mother. She's grieving also. She loved Jolene like a daughter.
I didn't ask any questions. The lost look in his eyes told me he was still processing her death. I won't take up any more of your time, I said. I just wanted to say how sorry I am.
Thank you, Emma.
I hurried out of the house before his mother returned. The front porch was overflowing with bodies, and I tried to nudge my way through them. Before I made it to the steps, the sound of sobbing drew my attention to the far end of the porch. The crowd parted just enough to reveal a girl on the porch swing. With her long blonde hair and unblemished skin, she looked no older than 17. She appeared distraught, her eyes red and swollen, and her cheeks stained with tears. Is she hurt? I asked aloud.
Not hurt, just hurtin',
a man said.
That's Kayla. She's the one who found Jolene.
Poor thing. She'd be forever scarred by a single moment. Younger sister? I asked.
Jolene's cousin. She'd been fighting with her own parents, so Jolene had taken her in. She'd always been like a big sister to her.
And now she was gone. Although I didn't have siblings, I'd lost my mother and father at a young age. I knew that kind of grief intimately. The loss of someone you loved and looked up to. I'm going to see if she's okay, I said. It seemed like the adults were preoccupied with comforting each other, and Kayla had been brushed aside. I threaded my way through the bodies until I reached the porch swing. Kayla glanced up at me, her brown eyes shining. Anyone sitting here? I asked. Wordlessly, she shook her head. I plopped down beside her and gently pushed against the floor with my feet so the swing moved. I'd always taken comfort in rocking motions. I don't know you, the girl said.
I'm a Hart, I replied. I'm new in town.
Her brow lifted slightly.
The witch?
I nodded.
How are you holding up?
I heard you're the one who found Jolene. Kayla sniffed and drew her knees to her chest.
Found her on the kitchen floor. I'd only been in the shower for about 5 minutes.
Had you seen her at all this morning?
Of course. It was the same as any other morning. Alex left for work. I went downstairs and ate breakfast, then brought Jolene a cup of coffee.
In her bedroom? Kayla nodded.
Jolene's been a late riser as long as I've known her. Sometimes she doesn't want to get up.
She trailed off.
Anyway, I got into the habit of bringing her coffee to try and drag her butt out of bed. Been working, too.
So after you stopped by her room and went into the shower, she went downstairs to the kitchen. Is that typical?
Not really. She usually hung around in bed a while longer, reading or doing a crossword. By the time I'd get out of the shower, she was still in her room.
But not today?
No. She went downstairs, I guess, to get her breakfast.
She paused.
I thought maybe he was coming by again.
Who's he?
Same as I told the Alpha and Sheriff Hugo, she said. That angel I used to see skulking around here after Alex went to work.
Angel? I echoed. There was only one angel I knew of in Spellbound.
Daniel Starr.
She gave me a hesitant glance.
You know him, don't you? I heard he trapped you here.
He didn't trap me, I said. Not on purpose. What do you mean that he was skulking around? Kayla shrugged.
You must have heard about his reputation by now.
Daniel's history was difficult to avoid. I seemed to encounter bitter women everywhere I turned in Spellbound. From what I understand, Daniel's affairs were quite some time ago. And much to my dismay, he'd sworn off the opposite sex right in front of me only a couple of weeks ago. He viewed the sacrifice as his shot at redemption.
I'm not saying they were definitely bumping uglies, but they seemed mighty comfortable with one another. If I were Alex, I wouldn't have liked it one bit.
Did you ever mention Daniel's visits to Alex? I asked in a low voice. I didn't want anyone to hear me asking questions, not after Sheriff Hugo's multiple warnings the last time I got involved in a case. But this was Daniel she was talking about. I couldn't let it go. I felt a sense of obligation to him, and probably a few other emotions I pushed down and ignored. Kayla plucked at a loose piece of wood on the seat of the swing.
I didn't, but now I'm wondering if I should have done.
A shadow fell over us, and I recognized its owner without so much as a glance at his hooves.
Is this witch bothering you, Kayla?
No, Sheriff, Kayla replied. We were just getting to know each other.
Sheriff Hugo narrowed his eyes at me.
Do you have a training class to go to? Maybe learn to wield that wand of yours without injuring others.
He was right. I had an afternoon class with the head witch, Lady Weatherby. She already seemed to dislike me. It would not be a smart move to show up late. I gave Kayla a quick pat on the leg.
Take care of yourself. If you need someone to talk to.
If she needs someone to talk, that's what the pack is for.
Lorenzo appeared beside the sheriff.
As I was just explaining to Sheriff Hugo, the pack can handle this matter just fine without interference.
I resisted the urge to smile.
You mean you're kicking the sheriff off the case?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.